The shepherd who will guide us. Dear Lord, we wait for your coming as our good shepherd. Please gather us in your arms. Feed us with spiritual food. And wipe away every tear from our eyes. Hear us, Shepherd of Israel. Let your face shine on us that we may be saved.
Oh, God.
You who are the hope of the world and the fulfillment of our greatest and highest hopes. For you are the holy God, and we invoke your name upon our fellowship and our worship this day. In Jesus' name. Amen. How good it is to welcome you to fellowship and the faith expression that we share in worship on this rainy day. But you made it to church on a rainy day, just so it doesn't snow, right? Well, that's that four-letter word that people say that sometimes. We shall see what the Lord brings us in terms of winter weather. But I'm really glad you are here today to experience the warmth of being with our brothers and sisters in Christ. How great that is. What's going on? Well, today, after worship, WMU, meeting right after service, all ladies are welcome to attend that. And tomorrow, Golden Years, getting together at 11:30 at church, and that's like for food, fellowship, and fun, right? So everybody's invited to that as well. Come on, I'll be there, front row. And something very special is happening next Sunday morning. Hey, Victor, you want us to give us a little preview or tell us about that a little bit?
So, y'all, next Sunday, as you know, we do our Christmas program every year, and we're doing that next Sunday. And so, I hope you, all of you on YouTube land will tune in, and Facebook land, and the rest of you will also come in person to the Lord Mary. Tony and I, and featuring also Holly Griffin, will be doing a variety of different tunes that are hymns of the holidays for the Christmas season. So, I hope you guys come and enjoy that. We'll be doing it on Sunday, and of course, we have our Bible after that. So, yeah.
Hymns of the holidays, that sounds great. And I think this is real Christmas here. You know, the world had all this, but here we have real Christmas. And that'll be a very important part of it. Looking forward to it. And yeah, as you mentioned, afterwards, there's food. Now, the church is going to provide chicken, desserts, and the drinks. Okay, so don't bring chicken. Well, deviled eggs will be fine, you know, those kind of things. Don't bring chicken. Don't bring desserts or drinks. We will bring other stuff. Bring a covered dish or two. Put something on the dish or in the dish, you know. That would be something for us to really, really enjoy. Looking forward to that as well. Hey, and we've got some other very important things coming up here. Have you grabbed one of these envelopes? This is for the Light of Moon Christmas offering. And it supports what? International missions. Missions around the world. How can we reach the world? Through a simple filling of this with a gift. And the gift is going to God, of course, because the gospel is God's to share. And we can be part of that. Got another envelope. This is for our regular giving. And these are available, as indicated. If you need a bunch, Dana can provide it for you. Dana Long, our secretary. There's some available out right by the office. Just ask, okay? However you use these during the year. And I would have to say, thank you. Thank you for giving to the Lord through your church. It's very much appreciated. Thank you very, very much for all the giving that you do. Now, as we continue in worship, we just simply say this. Now hear this. That gets your attention, doesn't it?
Yes.
What's coming next? As you read the Old Testament, don't you see that over and over again? The prophet goes to Israel and says, now hear this. And Isaiah has a message, and Jeremiah has a message, and Ezekiel has a message. Do the people have to listen? Did they listen? Sometimes they did. Sometimes they didn't. Our scripture reading this morning is an example from the prophet Isaiah, who, once again, goes to the people and says, now hear this. May we be a people who now hear this.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The Bible reading today is from Isaiah 64:1-7. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains would tremble before you. As when fire sets twigs abroad, ablaze, and causes water to boil, come down to make your name known to your enemies and cause the nations to quake before you. For when you did awesome things that you did not expect, you came down and the mountains trembled before you. Since ancient times, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your ways. But when you continue to sin against them, you are angry. How then can we be saved? All of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. We all shrivel up like a leaf, and like the wind, our sins sweep us away. No one calls on your name or strives to lay hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have given us over to our sins. Please bless the reading of your word.
You have that scripture before you in your bulletin. I call your attention to verse 4. Or how does he describe God? He describes God as the one who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. Who acts on behalf of those who wait for him. Advent is all about the season of waiting. So we wait on the Lord with great expectation and hope. Let us take these moments to bow our heads and go to the Lord in prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we praise you as the God who engages. We praise you as the God who calls us out. We praise you as the God who corrects us. For Lord, as Isaiah has shown us so very, very pointedly, we need correcting. We think we're doing great. We think we're doing fine. We have very low standards of expectations for ourselves, and we think we exceed them. But compared to the righteousness of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, we are falling woefully short. For he perfectly carried out your will and carries out your will today. And he called us, we know, to be perfect, to be complete, even as he is. So may it be this day, Lord, that you find us willing to heed, willing to engage, willing to be corrected, for if we keep going on our own path, it will not end well. For we know, dear Lord, that it is our sins that form a barrier between us and you, and we have to confess our sins. And we know that you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thank you for the amazing ways that you reveal yourself in our lives every day. May we take our blessings and be grateful. Lord, we pray that we're taking our blessings and sharing them. We pray that we're taking our blessings and making this world a better place. We hope, Lord, that it will become what you want it to be. We thank you that we can be called your people. We hope that we make you proud. In Jesus' name, amen.
The young Spanish hymn will sing number 93, It Came Upon the Midnight Clear, all verses.
Thank you.
Christmas is the season of giving. I want you to think of the best gift that you've ever been given. Right, you got it? I hope you thought of Jesus, the greatest gift ever given to the world. Let us pray. Almighty God, thank you for the gift of Jesus. We now offer praises and our gifts to you with a thankful heart for all the blessings you have given to us. Bless our offerings and use them to further your kingdom here on earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The words we meet.
that jacket? Oh, man. You know, when the Reverend Richard Pearson was the pastor of Crescent Park United Methodist Church in Sioux City, Iowa, there were several years that they had, they put on living nativity at their church. You've seen living nativities, right? They had all sorts of animals and characters there, people dressed up. Well, one night it was Pastor Pearson's job to get one of the sheep to the living nativity. And they had this pregnant ewe that he kept in his garage. And he and another church member carefully loaded this pregnant sheep into the back of a pickup truck. And Pastor Pearson rode in the back of the pickup truck with the sheep. And lo and behold, that ewe really didn't like it that it was so cold and took exception to riding in the back of a pickup truck. So they were stopped at a traffic light. That ewe decided to jump out the back and go running through the streets with Pastor Pearson running after her as best he could. Well, people stopped. People were yelling. People were laughing. People were pointing. This view of this preacher chasing after this sheep. Finally, he was able to corner it in the bushes at Briarcliff College, and very carefully loaded her back in the truck, hung on to her. They got to the living nativity with about 2 minutes to spare. The pastor said, all the way there, all he could think about was those lines from the song My Fair Lady kept running through his head. Kick up a rumpus, don't forget the compass, but get me to the church on time. This time of year can be real hectic, can't it? I hope it's not too hectic for you. Not like that, at least anyway. But it seems like time comes at a premium for a lot of people during what we call the Advent season, and they call Christmas season. Gotta do this, gotta do that. Lights to put up, and trees to decorate, and parties to attend, and meals to prepare, and Christmas cards to get out, all these presents to wrap. How can you possibly get it all done? Well, the season of Advent ought to find us getting ready for what Jeremy was talking about, the best present that God has made to the world, and our best present in life. Advent is the definitive announcement of our future, our present and our future. Advent, part of it is not just that he came, but he's coming back to fully establish his kingdom. And it will be a triumph over death and a triumph over darkness. And that's why I kind of want to tie what Isaiah said to what we were talking about and read from the scriptures last week from Mark, the 13th chapter. Remember when Jesus is warning them? He says, the kingdom of God is like a master who going off on a trip, and he puts the servants in charge, and he puts one by the door, and he says, what? Watch. Stay awake. You don't know when I'm coming back, so be ready. And I want to point out something from that scripture that's pretty cool, where he said, you do not know when the owner of the house will come back, whether in the evening or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or at dawn. You don't know. So what does he say? Watch. Watch. What I say to everyone. Watch. If I were to ask you, when was the last time you thought about Jesus coming back, his return? You might say, well, I haven't for a while. I haven't thought about it. And we all know that there are people out there who come up with all sorts of dramatic predictions and expectations, and they put it on billboards, and they write about it, and they talk about the rapture, and that it's coming, and it's happening soon, or on a specific date. We find them a little bit eccentric, right? Well, and yet, biblically, we can't ignore this teaching. I mean, it's true. History has a direction, and Christ will return to completely fulfill the will of God in this world. It's a amazing, wonderful promise for our future, and one that we hope for, because we know that we are in God's hands, and we take this seriously. And we ought to be prepared for the day of His coming. Be prepared. When Christ says to His disciples, "Therefore, keep watch, you don't know when the owner of the house is coming back," and I point out these time references. You don't know if it'll be in the evening, you don't know if it'll be at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or at dawn. And the preacher, Tom Long, Dr. Tom Long, pointed out some very interesting insights from the Gospel of Mark having to do with those time references. And we can take a look at each one of them and how they really happen in the Gospel of Mark and the life and the events of what Jesus did. We take, for instance, you don't know whether he will come back in the evening. In the evening. Now, in the very next chapter of Mark, we find out, and when it was evening, he was with his disciples in that what we call the Last Supper, the last time he was going to be with them in this way before his crucifixion and death. And what happened there? When it was evening, Jesus ate his very last meal with his disciples and tells them, "One of you will betray me." So evening is a time of betrayal. Would it not be a betrayal of Christ if during this Advent season we totally forgot the true meaning of Christ's birth? That would be a betrayal, would it not? On Christmas Eve in 1932, Robert McGinsey attended a midnight service in the heart of New York City. And he felt so inspired by that service. And he had a good feeling as he was walking the streets of New York on his way home. But on the way, he was passing all of these bars and all of these businesses where people were yelling and they were screaming and they were swearing, and some people were so drunk they were passed out on the sidewalk. And he thought to himself, what a strange way to celebrate the birth of the most perfect person who ever lived on earth. And then he thought to himself, we seem to have missed the whole significance of Christ's life. So he went to his one apartment, he sat down, and on the back of an envelope, he wrote these words, which became the basis for a beautiful Christmas song. And it works with these. "Sweet little Jesus boy, they made you be born in a manger. Sweet little holy child, we didn't know who you was. Didn't know you'd come to save us, Lord, to take our sins away. Our eyes was blind, we couldn't see. We didn't know who you was." Have you ever heard that song? We'll get Victor to sing it for us sometime. Not today, sometime. How true. First disciples didn't understand who he was. And betrayal can come in many forms. For us, it may be our ignoring the needs of others around us. It may be focusing all of our energy on trivial things and not on the truly important things. It may be when we give ourselves over to rampant materialism again at Christmas. Betrayal comes in many forms. Did you know that the amount of money that Americans spend on toys every year exceeds the gross national product of 64 countries combined? 64 countries, the total they spend doesn't even equal how much Americans spend on toys. And there are all kind of toys, aren't there? Toys for little ones, and toys for big boys and girls as well. When it was evening, Jesus is with his disciples, and he says to them, "One of you will betray me." The evening, a time of betrayal. "Therefore, keep watch. You don't know when the owner whether at evening or at midnight. What about midnight? Mark continues telling us, after the Lord's Supper, they went out where? To a place called Gethsemane. And what happened there? Jesus prays. He prays hard. He is wrestling hard with the spiritual burden that he has about what is about to happen to him. He prays, Lord, Father, if this cup can pass from me, that's what I want. But not my will, but thine be done. And Mark says the close friends that he had go with him, while he was busy praying so very hard, he came back and found them
sleeping.
And he challenges them on that, and the Bible says they don't know what to say. How could they? Here he is wrestling with this great burden, and they're asleep. Isn't that what Jesus warned us about? The Master's coming. Don't be asleep. Well, instead of standing on the promises, they were sleeping on the premises. And the question really ought to be, could that be us? Could that be us? We are the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, supposed to be making a difference in this world and in this community, and are we sleeping on the job? Could well be. Speaking of sleeping, a man went to his doctor because he felt like he really needed some help with his snoring. And the man told the doctor, he said, as soon as I go to sleep, I begin to snore. It happens all the time. What can I do? And the doctor said, does it bother your wife? And the man said, oh no, it disturbs the whole congregation. I saw him disturb the whole congregation. Wouldn't you? But falling asleep in church is funny, it's a joke or whatever. That's okay. But falling asleep in the faith? That's serious. Falling asleep in the way that we exercise, our belief in the Lord Jesus Christ, that is by far much worse. In the evening, they betrayed him. At midnight, they were asleep. And then it says, how about when the rooster crows? Go on to read the Gospel of Mark. What happens? We all know what happened. We read in chapter 14, Jesus warns them, all of you are going to fall away. That's what he told them at the Last Supper. And one guy speaks up and says, not me! Though everybody else does it, not me! Who was that?
Peter.
Peter said, I'll be with you. I'll stick with you. And Jesus says, what? Peter, before the rooster crows two times, you're going to betray me three times. He said, no, that won't happen. But you go on to read. There he was, challenged. You're one of those Galileans. He said, I was not. You're one of his friends. No, not me. Yeah, you are. No, I don't even know the guy. What happens? The rooster crows. Peter goes out and weeps. Have you ever wept because you did something really stupid? We don't talk much about grace at Christmas time, but we could because it deserves to be talked about. What are children told this time of year? Who's coming to town?
Santa
Claus is coming to them. And so you better be
good.
Good. If you're not good, you won't get anything for Christmas. Real conditional love, isn't it? But did Christ still love Peter after he betrayed him that way?
Yes.
Yeah, he did. He always did. And he always does. So it's not conditional love at all. Not from Jesus. Peter was not perfect. He messed up. You're not perfect. we mess up? And does God still love us?
Yes.
He sure does. But the crow of the rooster is a moment of grace. A moment of grace. Therefore, keep watch, because you don't know whether he's coming back in the evening, or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or at dawn. One more time reference. Read the night, right? Read on in the Gospel of Mark, and what happens? Mark 16. When the Sabbath day was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary, mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go to anoint the body of Jesus. As far as anyone did, right? Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, who will roll the stone away? And you know what happened. When they got there, did they find a dead man? No, just a messenger who said, he's not here. He's risen. At dawn, the women came and discovered the empty tomb. He's risen. Maybe you noticed that Advent and Christmas come at the darkest time of the year, right? That's symbolic. Darkness is humanity's essential state. But the Bible tells us that the light shines. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. 1 John 1:5. And what is the light? Not quite the right answer. Who is the light? Jesus is the light of the world. So, the evening of betrayal, the midnight when the disciples are asleep, the crowing of the rooster when another betrayal is taking place, and then the dawn of the resurrection. We're told, whatever the circumstance, be ready. Whatever the circumstance, be prepared. Whatever's going on, watch. Watch. Also, easier said than done, but we celebrate Advent during the darkest time of the year, but it's a celebration of light overcoming darkness. We know it's going to happen completely. It speaks of the day to come. David Peterson was a pastor who one day was in a real deep preparation for a sermon, and his little daughter came in where he was working there in the house and said, "Daddy, can we play?" And he answered, "Oh, honey, I'm sorry, I'd love to play right now, but I've got to finish preparing this sermon, and I'll be able to play with you in an hour." And she said, "Okay, when you're finished, Daddy, I'm going to give you a great big hug." He said, "Thank you very much." She started out of the room, and when she got to the door, suddenly she ran back to her daddy, and she gave him a great big bone-crushing hug. And after she finished doing that, he said to her, "Darling, you said you were going to give me the hug after I finished." And her big eyes looked up and she answered, "Daddy, I just wanted you to know what you have to look forward to." Isn't that sweet? Isn't that sweet? Advent is a reminder of what we have to look forward to. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for filling our present with your grace. Thank you for filling our future with such a wonderful hope, such a wonderful expectation, one that we will take as the value of fact for our lives. Now help us to live according to that fact. For we pray this in the name of our Savior. Amen.
Young standard able to sing number 113, We Three Kings of Orient Are, all verses.
Thank you.
There'll be food. And good music, right? Let's do that. Invite somebody. Bring them with you. I've called your attention to envelopes, two different kind of envelopes. One is for missions. You pick one up if you haven't already filled one out. Or your regular offering, which you use throughout the year. We want to be well equipped to move the kingdom forward across the world, right here. Now may the Lord send us out as people of hope. May the Lord put hope in our hearts. May hope energize us to live our faith in Jesus.